Hi, everybody. This is Vince Ornotto again with another episode of The Creative Process. Today, we're going to learn a little bit about the creative process of acting and theater with a friend of mine, John Amplis, who is a professor of theater at Point Park University. And John is also directly involved with the Pittsburgh Playhouse. He's been involved in over 100 plays, and also earlier in his career was in many George Romero films, including starring in Martin and being in Day of the Dead and some other work beyond that. I'm sure you're going to learn a lot today about acting and the theater.
The Creative Process with Vince Ornotto. Vince is a professional Pittsburgh artist that works in many mediums. And now Vince is going to share his creative process with you.
All right, what I wanted to start with is the beginning part of this, the process of becoming an actor, knowing you were an actor, thinking you might be way back when you were young, how that, you know, the germ of it, you're in school like anybody else, math class, spelling, what have you. How did that start coming through in your brain?
I had an uncle who was involved in community theater in Pittsburgh, my Uncle Jack. And so he did a lot of community theater. And when I was about 10, he took me and my cousin to an audition for a play called Dark at the Top of the Stairs. And so we auditioned, and I got the role of the young boy in the play.
10 years old.
And so that's kind of how it started. And I did a lot of community theater, you know, when he was involved in it generally.
When you went to do that, John, at that moment, were you thinking, I'd like, this is just a new thing to try this afternoon? Or were you thinking, I would like to...
Well, you know, I think there's a little bit of, in most of us, you know, so we want some attention, we want some approval,
right.
And so getting involved, and there were grown-ups involved, and you know, the big deal for me was that after the play, I would go with my uncle and his friends to get a cheeseburger and Cokes and French fries.
Yeah.
So it was
liked
a very,
it.
Yeah,
it.
I liked it. It was very social.
Yeah.
Different
than what the kids, other kids were doing.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's really the germ of it. That's,
yeah.
That's where it
and,
started.
So you get into high school, you started...
most of it was during the summer for the most part until I kind of fell away from it high school for a bit, although I did attend the Playhouse School in 63 to 66, but I played a lot of hooky. From the Playhouse School.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
But after high school, I went to the Army. So it didn't look like I was headed towards college. I didn't have that kind of background. I didn't have the grades for it. I wasn't that kid.
You're from Pittsburgh. Where
I
did
am.
You grow
I grew up in Hazelwood.
In Hazelwood, okay.
Yeah.
So you get into the Army, Vietnam comes into play.
I was in Vietnam.
Yeah. You were there a year?
A year from all of 70. I went in January of 70, came back in 70. Well, I came back just before 71.
And so you come back after being in the service, and what happens next?
You know, I got this kind of job, that kind of job wasn't very, I still didn't have a vision of what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
My last year in the Army, I was in Oakland, California, and I got involved in, there was a guy that worked with, on base that developed and directed plays. Again, more community theater type stuff, and I got involved in a play with him.
You're in the Army.
I was in the Army.
Yeah.
My last year, I was almost out.
Yeah.
You know, so that summer before I left.
You found something and you found your way drifting back.
And yeah, right. Well, I was always looking for something I thought would be easy. You know, knowing my...
Little did you know.
Yeah, exactly.
Join the real art club.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And I knew it was better than, you know, lifting hod and carrying cement, you know, so. Yeah.
We know that.
We do know that. So I did this little play, and then I got out of the Army. I still was kind of directionless. And then suddenly, for some reason, Point Park had, in 68, developed a four-year program. And I thought, okay, I can go to school on the GI Bill.
Yeah.
And I started here in 1972.
Yeah.
As a freshman.
Yeah. It's funny how, see, I relate to that, finding your way back to it again. We both are friends with Billy Price, and Billy was up at Penn State, and he kept finding his way back to music, and the band got better, he drops out of college, and so on and so on. But, you know, in the beginning, I kind of thought people, grade school, high school, acting school, or drawing school, and then you become a drawer or an actor. I have very few, I know a lot of people in the arts, and very few have a straight road like that, if any. It's all kind of, it's almost the same story, you know, with different faces.
Sure.
If you stay with it.
Yeah,
know?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you get involved in that, and so you're involved in college at the Playhouse.
Right here, on these stages. And I really liked it. I mean, I loved it.
Something's really connecting in a more mature way.
Absolutely. Mature is a funny question.
Well,
I mean, a funny word.
You're no longer at your uncle's
that's right.
community
No,
theater.
This is my choice. Yeah. This is my idea. This is something I want to do. And you know, the truth is, with my background, I didn't grow up with a close-knit family, you know. And my sisters and I were kind of separated very young in our lives. And we didn't get back to really know each other until after I got out of the Army.
Huh. Yeah. Plus, there was a separation of the Army.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the separation we never lived in the same households.
Okay.
So what I found in the theater was family, a home, a community.
Yeah.
And I think that's part and parcel of what theater does for us.
Right.
It creates this family that gets together for a very long period of time. Mm-hmm. Gets to know each other, has all of the same dynamics, mm-hmm. you know, people you can trust, people that maybe you have an argument with, people that,
right.
But it was a family, it was a home, it was a place where I was safe.
Common goal.
Absolutely, and it was the safety of it all, too.
So let's talk about the process. That's the overview of how...
Yeah, and it was in 82 that I was asked if I wanted to teach part-time. Mm. And so I said...
Point Park?
Yeah, here.
Yeah.
I said, okay, while I'm here, I should, you know, try that. Well, I've been doing it ever since.
Yeah. Did you like it right away, to teach?
I didn't like it right away. I didn't know how to do it.
Yeah,
and it's like most things that have come across my path.
Yeah.
Is that I have no idea how to do this, but if you give me some time, maybe, and
hit the ground running.
I really, you know, for me, it's always been about doing, not, it's about learning. It's on-the-job training, OJT.
Yeah.
You know, I find that I learn better in that way.
You know, it's funny. I was actually reading an investment book, and he said, he said 90% of anything you do new is the language. Like, I could tell, everyone knows what the word value means. Now, if I'm pointing at a portrait and say, I want to talk about the values, beginners have no idea. The concepts often aren't as difficult as you think, because you've got to get past the new language of the new environment.
Well, that's right. I teach freshmen primarily, and so The first in my class, the way I work is that it's all about learning the vocabulary.
Yeah.
First and foremost.
Yeah.
And learning that there's a thing called technique, which means how to do something. And you have to have some kind of basic understanding early on and be able to speak the language of the art form in order to communicate as artists in the field. So I start with Stanislavski and script analysis, and it's really those first month is that's where I stay with these kids.
Can you tell after a month which students, I'm not talking level of success, but which students get the idea of the work ethic that's coming from this, or those that, you know, that kind of thing?
Yeah. I got to say
this, I should say.
Yeah. But today, that's hardly a problem for most of our kids.
Okay.
They're very highly motivated.
Already.
Already.
Yeah.
And they're far more sophisticated, certainly, than I was even at 23 when I came to college.
Yeah.
You know, these 18, 19, there are a lot of them.
We were barely getting out of the neighborhood.
Barely.
Yeah. I mean, you did have the Vietnam, and you were kind of forced to, but basically you took the neighborhood with you, I'm sure.
Absolutely. They're far more,
refined, a little sophisticated, if we could use that word. Know what's going on in the outer world outside.
A little more worldly.
Yeah, it's funny, the microcosm we would have lived in.
And have already done some training.
Ah, there you go. Yeah.
You know, that's the difference between the kind of student I was and the student that, my training was doing it. But their training was they had already taken classes, they had already, they have done it through...
True training.
Yeah, true training.
True training.
You know.
Okay, so you get involved in this and in your teaching, and now you start learning how to do it, and I can tell you enjoy it, just the way you talk. And I know you seem to really have a real love for the students and the process that they're involved in. So if I come up and I say, what is acting? I had to learn what a painting was. It wasn't what I thought it was, because I was always looking at the last mark the artist made. Once I understood that there was so much behind it, what's really going on, the inner life, the mind, the mind's eye, all these things. So now, to define acting, how would you explain it?
I have no clue. Mm. I don't know how to define it. I think it's different for every actor, you know, but I think too there are some basic things that you have to have. Yeah, you do have to have talent. In other words, a predisposed disposition to it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then you have to learn how to use that. Mm. The best way to communicate, I mean, it's one thing communicating in a classroom with pencil and paper, but for the actor, they have to communicate one-on-one with another human being and allow that to be honest,
mm-hmm.
you know.
They're part of a whole. You're kind of playing God a little bit when you're drawing. You're the master, you're there. When you're, this is interesting with musicians, too. You are in an ensemble. Even a one-act play, there's the writer, the director. That's fascinating to me.
Yeah,
that's one of the differences.
For sure. So there's a process that you want to learn. You want to learn how to rehearse, first and foremost. The first thing you have to do is read the play.
sounds obvious.
It does sound obvious, but
and then know your lines.
Yeah, but it's you have to know all the lines. You have to learn how to learn.
Should an
those
actor
lines.
They read the play? Should they read something else the playwright wrote about what they thought of?
They
that
can.
Character?
You should do as much. You should do as much as is going to help you do your job.
Okay.
You know. So sure, it's. it's that NBC thing, the more you know.
A couple points. One of the, Edward Hopper wrote a letter to a museum. They wanted him to comment on a couple paintings of his. And this was the first place I saw this. He said, he made a couple comments, and they said, by the way, if I could explain it precisely with words, then you don't need the painting. It should be able to do something words can't. Acting should be able to do something by showing that just explaining what that character can't do, it has to show it.
That's here's the way I think about it, is you can do a play without a playwright. You can do a play without words. You can do a play without a set.
Yeah.
You can do a play without lights and sound.
Yeah.
You can do a play without a director.
Yeah.
So the one thing you can't do a play without is the actor.
That's amazing. Yeah.
And that's why the stage is so, is it's about being immediate and present.
Yeah. I had the good fortune. No, go ahead.
He can cut some of this if he needs to, and I would if I were him.
And he will.
And that's good.
Yeah, yeah.
But if you're on stage, there's nothing you can cut. You can't go back. You can't, you know.
Yeah.
You got to be present. And that, I think, is the key to acting, whether it's on film or on stage.
Yeah.
The idea is you have to be present, involved
and
in
letting
that
go
moment.
Of all the other stuff in your mind.
Yeah, there can't be anything else in your mind except that thing that you want right now.
Yeah.
Now, that's easier said than done, of course.
Well, that's interesting, too. See, that's part of the craft of it, regardless of your level of talent.
That's right.
Because you might not have a line on the stage for a good 10 minutes, even.
But you better be there involved in every bit of those 10 minutes.
Yeah.
You better be involved in the given circumstances of the situation.
Yeah.
That's what given circumstances are.
Yeah.
I'm in a particular place, and I do a particular thing because I'm in this particular place. I'm with my old friend Vince, but I'm here doing an interview, which means there's a performance element to it.
Well, that's the other
that
thing.
I'm a little,
yeah, you have an audience.
I may be a little more heightened in this interview.
Audience is part of the play.
If we're sitting, at the cafe somewhere.
Cafe. Yeah, that's very interesting. So,
this is all a heightened reality.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
But we have to buy into. We want the idea of truth and belief is not about the actor being truthful, and it's not about the actor being believable. It's about the actor finding a scenic truth, a way to display the truth of that human.
Huh.
And it's about getting the audience to buy into the fact that you are who you say you are.
Yeah.
And so it's how I treat other people on stage is what makes them the king. They may be the king.
Yes.
But unless I bow and show deference,
nobody
knows it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. It's fun. Like when I see Othello, I truly hate Iago.
Yeah.
I mean, like,
absolutely.
I don't use that word too often. That's how well written it is and usually performed, I suppose.
Yeah.
It's almost like it was that real to me, that character, that pure ego manipulating and so on. This reminds me, I remember in college we read Perandello's Six Characters.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember at the time, again, I'm 19.
I had a resentment about that in college. I wanted to play the kid, the son in it. I wasn't cast. I had the stage manager. So.
Okay.
So I had a little resentment.
You haven't let go of it.
But yeah, I think I've
managed it.
It's been managed. Yeah, exactly.
I remember at 19, like I understood what the question was, or the characters were saying we're more real than people. Okay, and I would disagree on a pendulum. Like I'd go on the disagree side. As I got older, I understand that they are more real in many ways because you go through like I'm a neighbor, I'm a friend,
that's
I'm an artist,
that's
I'm
right.
So many different things. And I am and I'm like the world's worst liar in many ways, but still, you have to put up a little bit of a role playing in different situations.
Oh, of course you do.
And he, Perrinella, I think the characters are right. They are more real.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, you agree?
Yeah, I do. Yeah. I do agree.
Yeah, that's an interesting situation. As far as the one thing you said to me earlier when we were talking, I love the way you put that, that the form itself is the art. It's not, and the actors are like different colors on your palette. There's also music sometimes, all these
music,
things, the set.
Yeah. Sound, music, the set, the design, the theater that you're working in. Uh-huh. All of these things come down to what are the given circumstances here.
Yeah.
And that's what an actor has to pay attention to.
Yeah.
You know, they have to be they have to allow themselves to be up there.
Yeah.
Without thinking about themselves.
And that they're not running it.
They're not running it. All they have to do is listen.
Uh-huh.
Listening is more than just what you get through the ears. Listening is what you get through
the mind and heart.
The mind,
soul.
The art, the eyes,
yeah.
The touch,
yeah.
The feel. All of that is information that you uh-huh. take in. Uh-huh. Now, it happens very quickly,
yeah.
Of course.
Yeah.
But that's information that you take in. And if you are listening, then that triggers something in you. Do I like what you're saying? Do I not like what you're saying? All of that is going to color how I express my point of view back
yes.
to you. So
back
I
to you.
Have
yeah.
to I have to take in what it is you're saying and doing and have to make a decision about that in terms of how does that make me feel.
Right.
And then I have to express how I feel.
Yes.
So there's a give and take here.
Yeah.
And it also comes from, you know, it can come from the set, it can come from the environment, it comes from the temperature of the air, is it raining, is the sun out?
Yeah.
All of this is about given circumstances that you have to live within.
Yeah. And you're always probably, this is a question, going for the whole being greater than the sum of the parts.
Oh, yeah.
Always.
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 Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, there's... Right. As an actor on stage, I'm one guy mm-hmm. who has to be a part of the world of that play.
Yeah.
I'm not the world of the play.
Yeah, yeah.
The
yeah.
world of the play is what the playwright...
That is the form.
...is what we... Yeah. What the playwright is saying. That's
yeah.
his... That's his or her point of view. That's what we have to find. Now, that's not always an easy thing. Mm. We can't always, and now as a director, I have to think about, okay, what is the overall point of this play?
Mm-hmm.
And I may or may not have honed in on what the playwright.
That was my next step. Yeah,
yeah,
the playwright. Now the director.
The playwright's the most important artist in
Bingo.
The theater.
Yeah, yeah. And that's why, whether you're watching the Academy Awards or Tonys, the first thing they talk about is the writer. I want to thank
it.
The writer.
It's the writer.
Yeah. So the director, then what is the director's role?
Well, for me, it's a guy that has to be part of, be the person that has an overview and can sit, and again, here's that term, listen.
Yeah.
And learn how to collaborate.
Okay.
I don't always have the answer, and I'm not necessarily the smartest person in the room. So if I have any smarts at all, I'm going to listen to what other people have to say.
Fascinating. Yeah.
And
especially the playwright, even though they may be dead.
Even though they may be dead.
They have their words.
I have their words, and I have to respect that. And I have to work like hell to understand what that playwright's point of view
yeah,
is.
Yeah, when you're doing a play, John, how many times do you think you read the script?
Oh.
Countless.
100.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you have to go over it all the time.
You really do.
You really do. Sometimes you can have an idea about what the play is about. And you work towards achieving that.
Okay.
And then sometimes you're not quite so sure, so you have to start to work on it on a moment-to-moment basis instead.
Uh-huh.
and see where that leads.
Yeah.
Also, you have to be willing to change. You cannot be so rigid as to say, only my thoughts here matter. Mm-hmm. They don't. Mm-hmm. They matter, mm-hmm. but they matter in the collaboration with others that also have good thoughts.
Yes.
That may give you an idea that you hadn't thought
and
about.
And you're listening for input. The actor always might say one thing. So, you know, I thought of it this way. And you go, that's what I was looking for.
Yeah, that's good. That's a great idea. Yeah. Let's go your way. Let's do it your way because I think you're right.
Yeah. kind of winding down here, let me ask you, you've been involved in so much. Which play, tough question, that you were either directing, acting in, was you would say was your most favorite experience?
You know, we had, in 1984, we did a production of Mammoth's American Buffalo on this stage. And I worked with a very good friend of mine, who really was a terrific mentor to a lot of the students. He became a teacher here. He had worked with Romero as well back in the early days. He did a movie called Always Vanilla for George. His name is Raymond Lane.
Mm-hmm. Lane?
Lane, L-A-I-N-E, mm-hmm. Raymond Lane. Yeah. And so I worked with him on that, and I think that was one of...
Why?
I don't know. I think we all liked the play. It was a small, simply contained play. Mm-hmm. Coming from Hazelwood and the Greenfield area, it was a scrappy kind of... play and production that we all kind of felt a kinship with and understood it.
See, that's interesting. Again, it's something that the sum becomes greater than the individual parts. Something's happening here that separated that experience, but you couldn't put a prescription and say, oh, do it this way, then we'll be able to repeat that.
Right,
it's this energy thing. It's that intangible.
Yeah.
I remember I was fortunate. One of my trips to Italy, I went to Cinecittà, Fellini's studio.
Wow.
John, I walked in, paid my ticket, walked in, and all of a sudden I understood why they say it's magical.
Yeah.
Because I saw so many of his films, I recognized stuff right away, and it felt magical, and all I did was walk in.
You know, creating
Roman pillars.
I think creating art is all about family. Is all about having a good working relationship with other people.
Yeah.
I mean, it's okay to argue and fight about stuff.
You're having a deeper and real experience.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. And that experience of getting together and working, I love rehearsal more than I love to, you know, as a director, I could stay in rehearsal forever, you know. But once it's on stage,
the painting's
done. I'm finished, you know,
right.
For all practical purposes.
That's very interesting.
And then it becomes, and that's why in theater, the actor is so important.
Yes.
Because then it becomes the actor's job.
Interesting.
The actor takes
lateral
over
the football.
They have to.
Yeah. Yeah.
They're live.
You're in the back. You can't even make a change right now.
No,
You're not even in the back.
No,
sometime.
I may give notes, but you know, if they take them or not, that's not going to be.
Well, I knew this would be fascinating, and
I could go on forever and ever and ever.
Keep listening, but it's interesting. I really appreciate the time.
Oh, same here, man.
Hope the audience learned a few things, and if you really want to have a neat experience, come to the Playhouse, come to live theater. I have so many friends that come to a play or go out and hear a band or something. I say, boy, I should do that more often. And
we have the professional company, which is the rep company, and we do three or four of those a year, and then we do you know, like I was saying, with our student productions, the conservatory productions, the children's productions, and then throw in a couple of dance shows, too.
Yes, you know. Okay.
We have a lot going on here, and this department is, I think, one of the strongest and best training programs in the country.
So get off the couch, get away from the flat screen, and see some real stuff.
That's right. That's it.